Welcome to Lowcountry Snapshots. I'm Courtney Guthrie. Today I'm talking with Roy Austin, a man who proves that the best is yet to come. He's had a long and wonderful history before he came to Sun City, but it was only on a recent trip to Africa where his heart got moved by the children who needed his help. Welcome to the show.
Thank you, Courtney. Appreciate you having me.
All right, let's start at the beginning, Roy. Okay. Where were you born?
Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania.
Pittsburgh. Mm-hmm. And what was your family like?
Well, there's not a whole lot to really tell, Courtney. I mean, we had just very loving parents. I had a brother. Everybody got along great. My parents never fought. I don't have a traumatic childhood story to tell you.
that's not a bad thing. But you did go off to college, and where was that?
I went to Bethany College in West Virginia, which was a small college, about 750, 800 students.
And what did you study?
I majored in economics there, and then went on from there to Michigan State for graduate school, and majored in marketing and management.
Okay, and then what came into your life?
Well, the Army came into my life, and they sent me over to Vietnam. And I was very fortunate. I was trained to be a forward observer and go out with an infantry company and call an artillery fire. But when I arrived, I was called into the personnel office, and this major holding a file folder, he said, "Lieutenant Austin." I said, "Yes, sir." He said, "I see that you have an MBA." I said, "Yes, sir." He said, "Would you like to work here?" And I said, "Sir, if that's where the Army needs me." So I was fortunate to be able to be more in an administrative role, and that gave me an opportunity to meet a lot of Vietnamese people who was very different. A lot of GIs met the Vietnamese people out in the jungle. They were didn't have very nice names to say about them. I got to know them as people and corresponded with several of them until the North Vietnamese took over, and I thought my letters would get them in trouble. But people everywhere are the same. They have loves and dreams and hopes and fears just the same. Their customs are different.
Now, you met the love of your life, and when would that happen, and how did that happen?
Met her at a singles group at a Methodist church, and kind of by happenstance. I didn't want to go to the group. A friend kept bugging me, and I just wasn't ready. And we're standing in line for this buffet dinner, and a guy behind me taps me on the shoulder. I'd never seen him before. I've never seen him since. And he says, "Do you think you'll ever get married again?" He doesn't say, "My name's Bob." He just says, "Do you think you'll ever get married again?" And I said, "I tell you what, I'm just going to find a woman I don't like and buy her a house." Well, Sharon thought that was funny. She thought it was original. She was several people up in line, and she came back and introduced herself. And eventually we became friends. We started playing tennis tournaments together, attended the same Sunday school class. And a couple of years later, we started dating. And it only took me 6 years to get her to the altar.
And how long after that did you move to Sun City?
Well, actually, I had moved here in 2000. We got married in 2002.
So you met her before, but then you moved here.
Yeah, she was a professor at Virginia Intermont College, and so she stayed up there working until she finished her, got to her retirement.
So how did you get interested in Africa?
I have always been interested in the animals in the wild. And I watch all these nature shows, and we love to travel together, but she, because of all her high blood pressure issues, she couldn't do long plane flights. And so she kept telling me, "Go to Africa while you're still able." She said, "I can't do it. But you've always wanted to see the animals in the wild while they're still in the wild." And so finally she brought it up enough times I didn't feel guilty leaving her behind. So I booked the tour to go, and we went to 5 countries over 5 weeks. And it was awesome. But the tour included all these visits to homes and schools and villages and markets and churches and so forth, none of which I cared about. I just want to see the animals. So I'm not looking for a project. If I've got to do all this cultural stuff in order to see the animals, great. That's so be it. But I found that I thoroughly loved meeting the African people and talking to them, and found them to be very warm, very generous, extremely resourceful, which you have to be in some of the environments that they live in. And I learned to speak a little Swahili, mainly so that when I went, I could say Cho Iko Wapi.
And what does that mean?
Where's the bathroom?
Oh, okay. Well, that's very important.
So that helped me get to know several people in Kenya and Tanzania where they speak Swahili, and I'm still in contact with many of them. But we visited a school in Amboseli National Park in Kenya, and which was located next to a tribe of Maasai. The Maasai had changed their whole way of life, or at least this tribe had, so their kids could get an education. Because historically, the Maasai are nomadic herdsmen. They take their goats and sheep and cattle, and if the grass gives out, they have to move. School buildings can't move. So they located more permanently next to the school. And I say permanently because we're talking about mud and stick huts. Some of them had tin roofs, surrounded by a barrier of acacia thorn branches about 7 feet tall, thorns about that long. That's to keep out the lions and the leopards. But locating next to the school created a problem for them, because now their warriors have to take the herds farther and farther away to graze. So they may be gone 2, 3, 4 weeks at a time. They don't have the benefit of that barrier, so they're at more peril, but education was that important to them, that they were willing to do that. That really impressed me, because I've known a lot of people that they wouldn't leave their street, let alone, you know, go somewhere else and do change. So then we went to the school, and they did a nice presentation. The teacher talked, and somebody in our tour group asked the teacher, "Do you have a library?" And her face lit up, and she smiled, and she said, "No, but we'd love to." I couldn't get that out of my head. I've never been involved with education in any way other than taking, you know, getting education. And I kept thinking, how hard can this be? We'll get some books donated, and we'll ship them over there. So when I came back and started on the project, the first thing I heard was, forget it, it'll never work. Books are too expensive to ship, and they'll get stolen in customs. So I mailed one book, got through. I mailed another book to a friend of mine that I'd gotten to know in Tanzania. It got through. And I mailed a box of books to the Amboseli school. Well, they got through. Apparently, there's no black market for books in Kenya.
But you did come up with a problem, and the problem is shipping costs. Is that not right?
Well, I was told FedEx is just completely out of sight. So we learned that we could mail books through the U.S. Post Office with their media rate. It's still expensive. A 35-pound box cost about $260. But we had become aware that of an organization called Books for Africa. They have been around since 1988, and they ship books to all 55 countries in Africa, over 50 million books in their 32-year history. You just pay them a fee. They have a warehouse full of books. They load the container, put it on a ship, take care of the logistics, get it through customs, get it on a truck, and haul the container up to a warehouse location we have in Kitui, Kenya. And so last August, when we settled my wife's estate, she was a big supporter of this project, and I thought, what better way to honor her than to, I'll pay for the container. It's $15,000. About a week later, Books for Africa said, we're going to have a 2-for-1 special in September, so we'll ship 2 containers for that $15,000. And that inspired one of my board members, and he got all excited, and he funded another container.
That's wonderful.
The first one arrived about 2 weeks ago, and it's all been unloaded. The books have been stamped in order to conform with the government regulations. We have to stamp them with our logo and a not for sale tag, because they don't want us sneaking books in to sell them. And they are in the process of being delivered to schools, mostly by motorcycle.
When you decided to start this, you also decided to start a formal organization, and that requires a name and a logo and all that. So how did you get your logo?
Well, there's a website called upwork.com, and you can post projects on there, and freelancers all over the world will bid on them. And so when I needed a logo, I put a project up there, and this guy in Kenya, and so that's the same way I got the website. A lady in Kenya answered. I had 23 bids from all over the world, most of them much more qualified than she was. But she said, I've never done a website all by myself, but I've worked on lots of them, and I've got a bunch of colleagues that can help me. Would you give me a chance? And I thought, she probably knows a lot more about the educational system in Kenya than the guy in the Philippines or Spain or wherever. So we hired her. She did a great job on the website. And then she started doing volunteer work for us without being asked.
What do you mean?
Well, she started connecting us with schools. We had a problem with some books that were shipped to a school that hadn't arrived. She travels 4 hours on public transportation, which is how many people can you cram into a minibus. And finds that the books are sitting at the post office. The teachers didn't understand they needed to go pick them up. There's no rural delivery over there, you know. And so I asked her, I said, Wanjiku, why are you so dedicated to this project? I'm not paying you anything. And she said, when I was in school, we had 30 to 40 kids in a class. One textbook. We all had to share one book. One English book, one science book, one math book, one Swahili book, whatever the subject was. Now, if you can imagine what that would have been like, I can't even imagine sharing a book with one other person, let alone 20 or 30. Right. So we hired her to be our operations coordinator, and she's been doing a fantastic job, and she's coordinating all the books coming in on the containers and getting them shipped out to schools. The 8 containers, and it turns out that the containers have more books on them than we thought they were going to have. So each container will create libraries in about 200 schools. 8 containers, that's 1,600 schools. So that the schools average about 150 kids. And they're rural. They don't have internet. They don't have electricity. So that'll impact the lives of about 250,000 children. All I wanted to do was ship to one school, you know, and it just kind of, God kept opening up doors is the only way I can put it.
So tell me a little bit about how your wife was connected to this project as well. She had a student that lived.
Well, that's kind of in the future of our goals, but Sharon had a student from Uganda.
She was a professor.
You're right. She taught computer applications, and she was an English major also, so she was very interested in education. And so I've gotten in touch with Godfrey in Uganda, and he's very anxious for us to bring libraries for kids to Uganda. And I said, well, we got to take care of Kenya first. There's over 6,700 rural schools in Kenya. Now, if you do the math, that works out to 1,000,000 children. So that's our immediate goal, is 1,000,000 children. And then, you know, we've got contacts with Godfrey in Uganda. I've got a couple people in Tanzania that I came to know that are interested in helping out. So hopefully eventually we'll expand into other areas.
So when you came home from Africa and you were telling your wife all about this trip, was that the first thing you said to her was, I've got this on my mind and I've got to do this? Or did you tell her about the animals?
No, we mostly talked about the animals, and I mean, she would have absolutely loved the whole thing, all the visits to the markets, the slums, even we went in to see a tribe of Bushmen and shot bows and arrow with them. They've lived that way for 10,000 years. They're very primitive. And that was really a thrill.
So at what point did you bring up with her this idea?
I don't know. I just kind of percolated along. You know, no, she was behind it all the way because she believed in education. And she was not only supporting it emotionally, but she was supporting it financially, too. So.
And you carried that through after she passed away.
Well, what better way can I honor her legacy than to keep this going? And she would be extremely upset with me if I just folded my tent and didn't keep it going as much as I possibly could.
That is a beautiful testament to her life, that you will do that in her memory. So you said the future plans is to get to 1 million. Do you have any needs or any suggestions to people watching as to how they can help you?
It's all boiled down to money now. I mean, we need money to ship more containers. Once the books arrive, we have to pay people to deliver them to the schools, so we need money for that. Our website, librariesforkids.org, library4kids.org. We've got a crowdfunding site on GoFundMe and GiveSendGo, so those are a couple places. Or you can just send me a check if you want to at my address here at 15 Trescott Lane in Bluffton. Any of those work.
Okay, well, I so appreciate your time and I appreciate your effort. I know these kids are going to grow up and they're going to think that somebody did this for them and be able to be much better able to help with their own communities there in Africa because of the work you're doing right from Sun City.
Well, when I see the pictures and the videos of those kids and how they just are devouring these books, and even the teachers are saying, we have more resources, not only that we can give the kids supplemental reading assignments, but we have resources for ourselves. We always try to send encyclopedias too.
Oh, that's amazing. Well, thank you so much for your time.
Well, thank you.
And best of luck to you.
I think you appreciate you taking the time to tell the story about Libraries for Kids.
Sun City Man has made it his mission to help children in underdeveloped countries. Our Alex Littlehales reports.
A Lowcountry Man's trip halfway across the world led to more than just some vacation photos, but a renewed purpose. Sometimes life is not what it's supposed to be. Like when Roy Austin took a trip across the world expecting one thing.
Well, I went to Africa for one reason and one reason only. I wanted to see the animals in the wild while they're still in the wild.
Only to find his true purpose was for something else.
One of the people in our tour group asked the teacher, do you have a library? And her eyes lit up and she said, no, but we'd love to. And so I couldn't get that out of my head. I thought, well, how hard can this be?
Inspired from his return, Austin started Libraries for Kids International, a Lowcountry nonprofit collecting and donating books to rural schools in Africa.
I have no idea. Hundreds, really.
His books safe and secured after a donation from a local storage company. And his efforts already reaching 11 schools in Kenya.
And I had several people tell me this won't work. It's too expensive to ship books and they'll get lost in customs. Well, we found less expensive ways to ship the books.
But through the beginning stages of his cause, he has also suffered loss.
What do you miss most about her?
Her smile and her laugh.
The loss of his wife this March. But Austin knows from the way she lived her life, she'd want him to turn the next page and continue his mission.
She lived this. Life is not what it's supposed to be. It's what it is.
How you cope with it is what makes the difference.
Roy Austin says that some of his long-term goals are to maybe expand into other countries, like in South America as well. I'm Alex Little-Hales reporting. Back to you.
Welcome back to Talk of the Town. We are joined by Coach Roy Austin. It's so good to have you here. You always, this gentleman, you always have so much going on. You just quietly give. It's so wonderful to see what you're up to. And so you have a new organization, Libraries for Kids.
Yeah. Well, thank you, Carrie. Appreciate you having me on the show.
Of course.
And give the opportunity to talk about Libraries for Kids.
Yeah, this was one of those things that just sort of, you went on a trip. Mm-hmm. And you kind of had one thing in mind, and then something totally different happened. You had a different, totally different takeaway.
Right.
Tell us a little bit about your trip to Africa.
Well, I went the last September, and I went to see the animals.
Yeah.
The trip had a lot of cultural experiences of visits to homes and schools and villages, and I didn't care about that. I just wanted to see the animals in the wild while they're still in the wild.
Yeah, exactly.
But I fell in love with the people. They're just so warm and interesting. And
you were in Kenya?
Yeah, well, I was in five different countries.
Oh, okay,
so.
Okay.
But on a visit to a school in Kenya, which was really the highlight, sitting down with these kids who all spoke English, so it was just great. One of the people in our group asked the teacher, "Do you have a library?" And the teacher said, "No, but we'd love to." And I couldn't get that out of my head.
Yeah, the idea was it took hold of you.
And I kept thinking, surely I could get some books donated and ship them over there.
Yeah.
And so I came back, and one thing led to another. We got our tax exemption back in May and got a nice website up there that was done by a lady who lives in Kenya, or is Kenyan. We've successfully shipped 130 pounds of books over there to that school.
Yeah.
And I have a list of 11 other schools that we can help.
These underserved schools that just need some books.
Well, the Kenyan government gives very little support to the rural schools. Now, if you want a school building, you build it yourself. So they'll supply a teacher and some books, you know, maybe replace them every 10 years or whatever, but they don't have the money for a lot of support of the rural schools. But what impressed me so much about this school was that it was located next to a tribe of Maasai. And this Maasai tribe had changed their whole way of life so that their children can get an education. Maasai are historically nomadic herdsmen.
Yeah.
They take their goats and sheep and cattle wherever the grass is. But school buildings can't move.
Right, exactly.
So they stayed more permanently next to the school, which puts the warriors at greater risk because now they have to take the herds farther away to graze, and they may be gone 2, 3, 4 weeks at a time. You know, there's lions and leopards and so forth out there. So they're at greater risk, but education is that important to them.
That's wonderful, absolutely wonderful. And this is a really an interesting time for you to be doing this, because we've had this, you know, books are, I hate to say it, but books are almost sort of a thing of the past for some people, you know? So what a great, and how, can we just give you books, or what can we do to get these books to you?
Right.
And not that books are a thing of the past, but I mean, people have transitioned so much into electronic books that, you know, how many, we have books around, you
know? They don't have the electrical capacity to support a bank of tablets or whatever, or computers. So
I mean, they just don't have the infrastructure.
Right.
Yeah.
So, we've now, just this past week, got storage space so we can start accepting books other than my garage.
You know,
which
great
is
things
full.
Come out of garages. Great things can come out of garages.
And but now our biggest needs, now that we have storage, is money. Because it costs money to ship
those books.
To ship
heavy.
Those books over there.
Yeah.
Encyclopedias are great. Small dictionaries. Somebody donated one that was about that. That's a little bit overkill.
Yeah.
But
knowledge-based books. Do you need kid books? Do you need like easy reading
on
stuff?
On the website, there's which is librariesforkids.org.
Okay.
The number 4. Library is the number 4.
Yeah.
Kids.org.
There's a whole list of what your kids are.
There's a list of the types of books, and they're basically supplemental reading to their curricula.
Oh, great.
And, you know, some story books for children basically age 6 to 18.
Gotcha. Well, let's get you some books.
Yeah.
Let's get you some books. Libraries for the number kids Mm-hmm. Coach Roy Austin, always into something interesting and fabulous. Mm-hmm. Thanks so much for doing what you do.
My pleasure.
We'll
Thank
drum
you.
Up some books for you. We'll be right back with more Talk of the Town.
Thank you, Mr. Roy and Reverend, for your donation. The learning materials you have donated to us will make a big boost to the teaching and learning in Shirley Grammar School. We really appreciate for your effort, and we need more assistance if you are able.
Decision of books, pens, pencil, rubbers, and sitting mat. God bless you. Thank you.
Kasi mami hapo. Kata hiyo sasa.